Later stages are probably going to be the most interesting competitive matches that we have seen in a long time because of this rule. It's going to be really fun. I'm really thinking that we should be figuring out what to do with the random gods, because I'm thinking the random civilization is a bit like going against the spirit of the rule. So I'm thinking that's something that should be probably handled. But otherwise, we are going to be coming into a proper second game this time. Now Bubes is going to be switching into Loki, and we're going to be switching into a proper winter theme. Oh man, what I would give for a winter theme at this point. We are not having all that high heats anymore. Seems like we're going to be getting much more temperate summer in the July, but yeah, well, just a few days ago, that was really brutal. And I'm kind of guessing that plenty of you, especially those from Europe, were having kind of similar thoughts I would be expecting. There we go. So it's going to be just a bit of a back TC already discovered for Bubes, aka Matreiuss, but so far it's not giving him extra gold. There still could be gold like here. He's at least having plenty of food all across available to him. There's going to be, of course, a bit of it on the way back as well. As in the front side, this is going to be for 50 shades. Both TCs on one side. That is usually something that I don't like to see all that much, because it really kind of limits and forces you into certain type of play. And limits map control and overall like that. He's going to be forced, of course, in controlling the right side altogether. Luckily, he does have the gold mines there as well. Especially the one all the way back is going to be quite helpful. So it doesn't have to be that bad in this case. But of course, with the second TC for Bubes being somewhere here, I'm guessing he's going to be having a few more options how to go around the plane. Okay, so he's going to be already heading forward to the hunt. Let's see if Bubes is going to be a bit annoying. Apparently doesn't want to be feeling like that all that much. He's going to be though spied. I was just going to be looking at the village. 25% melee armor. Ulfsak is, or the scaling is at 30%. 80 hit points. Villager is at 65 hit points, but 8 attack. And the scaling is having only 2.7. So you can definitely expect that the village would be kicking his ass. And it doesn't matter if it would be a male or a female in that. Yeah, well, Skrelin won't be having all that much of a chance against all of that muscle and sinew, and maybe even a bit of fat in there as well. And there's plenty of goatees already captured for 50 shades. All the way to the bottom, plenty of them also available for Bubes. That's basically just the starting number of all the resources. And so far, the closest gold mine is quite far away. Like, really quite far away, not entirely close by in any kind of good position, so he has to be hoping that on the left side it's gonna be slightly better, right next to the back TC here. So far he doesn't even see that though, as he's building house in the middle of the map, just where he had the scaling, and better cavalry movement speed. That's not bad. That's kind of not bad, but I'm kind of looking forward who's gonna be using it a bit more. I mean, like 50 shades as the Hades, you could be going for a combination. That's kind of alright TC, the position a bit forward, so giving him a bit of map control. There's going to be a gold mine somewhere here, I'm thinking on the left side. But anyway, to finish my thought, a combination of horses together with the Toxotai is usually quite strong against the opponents, being a Norse, and against the Loki, they're going to be a bit tricky. Because this is really, the Loki is quite powerful against the Greeks in the Classical Age, for the sole reason that if he gets the go-in with all the mythical units, then the Greek usually has quite a significant issue dealing with it. If he's not Zeus, even Zeus does have problems with that. Because you have only two heroes. The first age hero is really easy to kill. For the Heresiers and for pretty much anything else. And the second, Hippolyta and Odysseus, even though they are not really that bad, they are having really low attack, slow attack. So once you are going to be overwhelming the enemy army with like 3, 4, 5 mythical units, then you are suddenly in pretty deep trouble as the Greek. You need to be careful about that, as the Greeks are supposed to be using their own mythical units as counters to enemy mythical units. But yeah, well, that's usually not something that the other Greeks are all that prepared for. Besides Zeus, but it's not even all that much of a meta. Usually played a bit differently. In there, as 50 Shades is already going to be casting the Sentinels, kind of guessing why not. He's going to be getting raided, he's already expecting that. And coming yet again through Ares, so he really seems to be liking him. I mean, like, I like it for Hades, as Ares definitely does have good upgrades as far as the, how is it called, the Bow of Enyo? Hades. Yeah, Enyo's Bow of Horror. It's really pretty good. 10% extra pierce damage is not something that you need to be, or that you should be underestimating at all. As Bubes is apparently coming for double tempo, and it's going to be resulting into fairly standard build up for him, with the Force City advancing a bit later. Let's see if he's gonna be scouting it. Right now, I'm kind of liking where FiftyShades is going with how he's playing, also on the Sea of Worms. But problem is that he should be timing it slightly better and basically really trying to get the pestilence as soon as possible into the enemy, so that he can be basically blunting. Can be blunting the very start of all of this. Yeah, well, it's not gonna be exactly the case. Because imagine if he stopped this for 40 seconds, he will be denying like, I don't know, 4 or 5 Hersiers. The Hersiers are taking basically 23 build time. So you can be stopping, if you cast it properly, like 2.5 Hersier per temple. So really like 4 Hersiers. And the next ones are gonna be delayed as well. So that's quite important to be taken into consideration, as the relic number 2 is gonna be on the left side for house and manor hit points, which is kind of not bad. As the Norse hit points, or the Norse hit points on the houses are slightly lower. As all the way to the top side, FiftyShades is already casting the Pestilence for both temples, and it's gonna be still making at least a bit of effect. Fortunately, not all that much, you can see. But even making for the second one from the first one is gonna be eating like only half of the way. And half of the time. As plenty of hunt has been already right now disrupted. And there is gonna be even a longhouse all the way to the backside. It's an interesting position, all things considered. It's really far away from any kind of efficient place on the map, so slightly curious about that one. But much more importantly, all the way to the top side, FiftyShades is still spamming archers, and he can be probably using even a few villages to vilify this if he wants to, but he needs the hero here as soon as possible. That's 8.8 attack. The hit points are huge. Hit points are definitely huge, but he needs to pull it as soon as possible. Or rather, Chiron. He's Hades, he's not Poseidon anymore. Still used to him being Poseidon. Though he's Hades right about now, FiftyShades. And therefore, Chiron could be already coming forward right about now. No, problem is that it's way too close to the town center. So therefore it's shooting right about now the Cyclops. So those archers need to be coming back. Chiron as well. And Chiron just needs to be protecting, I'm thinking, this hunt. Because... oh, where is the troll? Did he die? Oh yeah, he did. He actually died here. And I don't think there was any kind of hero there, unless I'm mistaken. That is strange. That is strange indeed, but in the end, the Cyclops apparently fell for the tower, which is... no, it doesn't have to be such a bad idea, because it kind of free this way, unless it's gonna be properly walled here as soon as possible by Bubas, which it should be, away into gold. And the secondary gold mine is here, not great. Another gold mine is here. And here, which is like kind of reasonably okay, but still it's far away from any kind of defense. So this game is not badly started for FiftyShades. Has definitely some thought behind it, which I kind of like. So Gold Star might be becoming reality, but matreiuss is already working against that, recognizing that this is really pretty big threat to all his existence in the game. 1300 gold left still for him. And here we finally do get all those extra goodies. So pickaxe, Hall of Thanes. It's gonna be, of course, quite needed in there. But it seems to me that right about now FiftyShades is well prepared with all the archers, not really losing anything. Still even having the Kataskopos. And what he needs to be concentrating on is blocking the gold. He's in a pretty good position at this point for that. He's even right now getting rid of the hunt at the bottom. So this game is going really well for blue. Really well indeed. As all the way to the top, Bubas even switching into a few horses. Coming for the top side. Oh, that's very well played. Very good thinking. This is gonna be probably costing a few villages, I'm expecting to. FiftyShades, because he's having way too many villages on one ground. Basically 15 here. 18, like 19 villages on one spot, that's really risky. Especially since he's not having all that many new units here. Only one Toxotas. Oh, that's gonna be costly. It's gonna be costly, at least into economy downtime, but overall it's not really all that great. You can see that's so... whoa, quite a solid army. And FiftyShades, if he was actually trying to get a bit more aggressive, he's gonna be just out of range. I'm thinking if he stood beyond the tower. Beyond the tower, beyond the wall. It's gonna check. Probably gonna be showing us exactly. But it should be, I'm thinking, if they stand here, maybe they're gonna be able to pick off this one. Yeah, they actually are, but that's Chiron. Oh, they probably are able to shoot onto the right side in there. He maybe do have enough range, but right now, no, don't need to be going anywhere all that much, just continue shooting. What needs to be happening right now with all the numbers, as he's losing tons of villages, unfortunately, home in there, he needs to be getting medium Toxotai as soon as possible. He also needs to be getting definitely second archer range for exactly the upgrade and potentially even moving forward with a bit more units, as all the way to the bottom, there's gonna be just a bit of an army growing, and Wubes is definitely taking the opportunity right now to switch into more units. Problem is that once you are gonna be facing a massive Toxotile like this, this is really right now getting scary for the Norse, then the Norse gonna do anything about it. Even the horses are gonna be dying. So if this is gonna be switching into medium Toxotai in the next like a minute, then Matreiuss cannot do really anything about it all that much. He just needs to be hoping that he's gonna be getting quickly copper shields, exactly as he did, and getting a few upgrades, like for example medium cavalry. Because if he doesn't, then this is gonna be just a bit too much for him. Okay, he doesn't have gold, he doesn't have anything, he's not advancing, so he's in trouble right now, Bubes. He's gonna teeter in on the precipice a bit. Needs to be hoping that this is not gonna be, he's gonna be working for him a whole lot better than what right about now Blue is trying to do inside his base. He needs to be like keeping his opponent off the gold here, and then somehow in the long run trying to get rid of that. But the army is really getting stronger and stronger here all the time, and ever so long rather. Oh yeah, pretty much all the time. Let's not complicate the English here all that much, as the ghosts are also gonna be running out inevitably. And he's gonna be having to move somewhere else. How's it looking with 50 shades and echo? 400 food. He doesn't need all that much food right about now. He needs to be switching to other resources. But he's also right now moving onto the opponent on the food at the bottom. He needs to be really keeping pressure on the gold. Probably just screw the food. Just go for the gold. As without the gold, the opponent cannot do anything all that much. Only the trolls, pretty much. They don't cost any kind of gold to him. Ah, nice. Nice, that was 50 shades not running away. He was trying to find a choke point where he could be basically just putting the archers into one spot and they wouldn't be able to be surprised. And oh yeah, this is a very good spot. And surrounded by the enemy. So this is very good thinking. I'm not entirely certain if this is inspiration by and from Age of Empires 2, where this is basically one of the base skills, how to get at least decent. And in Age of Mythology it's not used all that much, but sometimes you see it. Because the pathing and the formations are kinda a bit more trickier. But those trolls are gonna be a problem. Especially if the Kainoids are gonna be microing enough. And I'm thinking that actually 50 shades should have been escaping at this point. Because he needs to be realizing that the mythic units are a much more bigger problem for him. Chiron against the Valkyrie. This is probably gonna be resulting in nothing all that good. Because of the mythic units especially. Yeah, good Kaitin. Sending this Hersir away. That was under attack. So yeah, this is right about now the difference of the mythic units. Much more importantly also the copper shields in there. And unfortunately, 50 shades not getting the medium upgrade in time. He got it only now. And it's gonna be just a bit too late. And you can see to the top side when they are in open field. Those archers are gonna be completely slaughtered. So the opportunity was there. But, oh well, right now switching into the Hersir instead of finishing off the Hamartros in there. So what I can see here from 50 Shades is that he has definitely very correct ideas how to play this game. He definitely does have the correct approach and whatnot, but unfortunately it seems that Matreiuss is just better in the execution overall. Well, not much of a surprise considering how top player Matreiuss is, but it also means that 50 Shades, well, he's just this close to being able to breach into the same levels of the gameplay, and certainly looking forward how he's gonna be improving in the times to come. But let's not call this game yet done or anything like that. Thing is though that right now Matreiuss is having significant advantage, and he has also moved onto the left side for the economy, and that's not gonna be in the power of 50 shades right now to be controlling, and he's gonna be losing the second game at this point in the proper manner. But that was a very good fight, and really 50 shades did have quite solid opportunities how to close it in and how to get on Matreiuss' horse there a bit as well. That was quite a nice game. Okay, let's check into the boss game. That's going to be right now Bubes. Apparently not winning economy. Let's see what kind of truth is in there. Oh yeah, that seems to be pretty much true this time around. Like 1500 resources difference. 1500 plus probably. 50 shades a bit more civilian units. But didn't do all that much of a difference in the end. Military count nice, but units killed only 34. Lost 72. Yeah, Bubes played it kinda correctly. With spamming a bit more mythical units in there. That's exactly what I said. Mythical units are a problem for Greek in the classical age. They really are. If you spam them, don't be afraid to do so against a Greek. If he doesn't have all that many centaurs, for example, or he's not even making anything like that, then that's certainly a way how to put him into even a corner. And you can see the ratings on 50 shades there. That was the huge assault on the main economy to the top. A bit of a score assault on Bubas, on the Hunt and on the Gold. Good ratings, but in the end it resulted into Matreiuss taking the second game of the match. GG.